All right, so presentation number two, its title is Your Application Login is Not For You. So building a great MuleSoft application requires that it serves the needs of others. We're going to identify who these customers are and then build an application logging strategy that helps them solve their issues. Same person as last presentation. So a well-built API or job doesn't just solve the need of the end customer. It also has to solve the needs of others throughout the whole lifetime the application is live. It of course has to provide a benefit to the customer, whether it's an API or job that performs an action to help someone. It also has to help the support team take care of this application after launch. It has to be easy to fix any bugs found or address new issues. And this could be done by yourself or by your development team. Or maybe in the future, it'll be someone on another team, another organization, or maybe even someone new to your team, but they joined after you've left. So it's important to single out the future developers as they present a new set of circumstances, as they might not have the context on why or what was happening when the application was first built. So in this presentation, we're going to focus on the support team. What are their responsibilities and needs, and how we can help them with the implementation choices we make as developers. We'll do this by analyzing their work on how they work with their number one tool, the logs. So there are multiple ways to find out the typical activities of someone supporting MuleSoft applications in production. You can simply ask them. You can request to shadow them for a period of time, which I highly recommend to everyone. I've done this many times. I've shadowed sales teams. I've shadowed people in call center departments. And it's amazing what you'll notice that you can fix easily for them, saving them a ton of time and headaches. And probably the best way to find out the typical tasks of someone on the support team is to do your job yourself. I was at one organization where they adopted this philosophy that if you built something, you were also responsible for it in production. So I was the support person for whatever I built. So our building today, let me show you what our use case is going to be. So let me pull up my Postman. So what we're going to pretend is we work at a company that has a website where customers can log on and they have to create an account in order to use our products. So what we've done is we've created two APIs for the website, which takes the customer's information, a create customer and then like a get customer information. And then to create customer, they passed in a bunch of fields, which is usually a forms on the website. And then what our APIs do, built in MuleSoft, is we kind of have the layered approach. So we have a process API and we have a system API. And I've scaled this down pretty considerably. So what happens is the process API takes the original request from our Postman, which we can evoke from a Postman, but it'll be from the website, transforms the data a little bit, and then passes it to the system API layer. And this is to create a customer. And then the system API layer is actually a wrapper around our MySQL database. And it just does an insert for the insert HTTP endpoints, or it does a select to get a customer on the get HTTP endpoint. So we have here a database that it writes to our system API, and it pretty much is simple. So it has an auto increment ID field, and it has the customer name and email. So the name you'll see here, first and last name, is combined into one database column. So that's pretty much what our process API do. It's pretty much a pass-through, except for it'll take the first name and last name from the website and combine it to one to make your full name, and it adds a default name, a default email address if nothing was provided. So that's kind of be what our built. So we're going to pretend now that we're the support team. So we're going to step in their shoes to figure out what their job is and what problems they go through. So our tip, we're going to put a use case, which is very typical, is that a customer calls in to our call center because they're the first line of defense, of point of contact. And then they say something like, I'm trying to sign up on your website, but I keep getting an error. So what the support person will do is they'll log a ticket. Sorry, the call center person will do, they'll log a ticket in one of these systems. Ticketing systems could be anything, could be like a ServiceNow. And someone in the support team would be the first person to try to answer it because it's a production issue. So they'll write a ticket that says, that just describes the details. Hey, customer calls in and complains that they're trying to sign up on our website, but it's not working. And then they'll identify the customer for us. So what do we do? We're the support person. What do we do? Well, the first thing we do is look in the logs. So I've actually deployed this application just as it is into Cloud Hub. So what a support person will do, we'll go into our production logs. Ignore the sandbox here. And they'll put on the, we'll say the process API. They'll look at the logs and try to see if they could figure out what happened with this customer. So as you can see here, the server has been started up since the 9th, and there's actually no activity at all. There's no logs. So there's not really much they can do, right? So as the developer never added any log messages. So the support person doesn't really know anything. So the only thing they can really do by looking at their logs is respond back to this ticket with, I don't see any errors. So because they didn't see any error in the logs. However, they know that the application does do get, does fetches as well as create clients, but because there's not logging anything, there's no way for them to do their job. So this isn't going to reflect very good on them, and it doesn't help solve the issue in any way. So why does it even matter that we can't see any errors? Because we don't even know if the request is making it to MuleSoft. Never mind if there's any errors or not. So if we go back as a developer, what can a developer do to help the support person in this situation? Well, they can log the requests coming from the website. So that's what we're going to do. So we're going to add some logs on the beginning and end of our process API that just say something like, received create customer request, and then on the end we're going to just say finished create customer request, and then we'll put that in the system API as well, just so that we know when we go into the system API logs that the request actually made it there. We're going to say inserting customer into database. And then at the end, I put in the wrong one. So it's important to always have that final logger in there, because if it reaches it, you know that it completed successfully. Because if not, we'd get an error in the middle and you would never see this message. Finished inserting customer. So if I save this up and now deploy it into production, into the logs, we can pretend if we were a developer, if we were the support person again, coming with this ticket, what their experience would be like if they had that extra information. So now they get the ticket, they go into their logging system, and they see a whole bunch of create customer request. So create customer request, and they see the finished customer request, And if they go into the system API, they'll see inserting customer to the database and finished inserting the database. So, and if they go to error, if they go to all priorities, errors, they don't see any errors. So now they have a little bit more information. So to answer their ticket, they can reply back with something that says, the application is successfully creating customers, but, and I'm not seeing any errors. So this is a little better answer than the first one. It doesn't really help the customer get their account created, but I guess it's better than nothing. So usually if you were to go back to the customer call agent and tell them, I see requests coming in and I don't see any errors, the logical answer they'll say is, well, can you verify that this customer was created? But can we? From the logs, we can't. There's no way, we have no way to see if that specific customer came in with the request and what happened. So in order to do that, we'd have to log, we have to get a log of some customer information. So as a developer, we want to help the support person. What can we log as the identifier? So it'll depend on our type of business. So if we're thinking about the customer is the one that initiating the issue, so how do they identify themselves? Is it by doing a GUID, like a, what is it, a 25-digit unique ID? Probably not. Even though we can easily add it, and it makes sense to us as developers, but a customer is not going to know their 128-bit identifier of our that we use for them inside of one of our enterprise systems. So something more likely would be, say, like an email address. So that's what we'll log. So the call center person takes their information, and we saw in our ticket we have their name and email address that they tried to create an account. So let's log that email address. So we could put in something like email equals, and then we could put it from the, sorry, the process API. We could put it from the payload coming in, but because we're crossing this HTTP connector, we're going to lose it. So let's set a variable quickly so that we can use it in our logs. So we'll say, we'll call this email. And then what are we using in the payload? Sorry, the transform message. So it's payload.emailaddress. So we'll put this in here. And then in our logger, what we could do is go email equals vars.email. And we're going to put that at the end here. And I recommend that if you are putting identifiers, try to use this key value pair with the equal signs in the middle. A lot of the enterprise logging systems like a Splunk or a Sumo Logic work really well with key value pairs. They're good at searching, and you can add them easily to like monitoring or dashboards instead of just like hiding it on a string. Even sometimes I find the MuleSoft logging doesn't find things too well if you don't put it as a key value pair. So we're going to do the same thing in our system API. So we're going to go set variable email. What do we call it? We call it just payload.email. And then in the logs, we can go vars.email. And then vars.email. And if I save this, there's actually one thing too. It's kind of a little pet peeve of mine. So whenever you log a variable, you take a variable from a JSON payload, this variable will actually be of type application JSON. So whenever you print it out in the logs, it gives a double quotes around it, which isn't a big deal, but it kind of drives me crazy. So to get rid of it, you just change it to the output type. So if I go data weave, yeah, we'll just add this to the to our variable so that our logs are clean. Save it all and deploy it. So I've done that again. So I've taken this exact application and I've deployed it already to Cloud Hub so that we can mimic what a support person does. And that application is this one identifier. So now you can see that now I have my identifier for all the requests coming in. So what I could do is take this and now search for it. So I have the information from the ticket of what the customers that had the issues email addresses. So I can just search for it and now I can see their actual request. So now as a support person, I have three more new pieces of information. So now I can reply back to the ticket with that I can see that we've received their requests. So I can now have, it's better than response two, so now I can specifically answer to the customer that had the issue. So we can find out now, well, what happened to the request? We received it, what happened to it? So to do that, what we have to do is take this email address and now take it into a system API and search for it there as well too. And then we can see that there, we can see the request that came in, seeing insert and finished. But because it looks like we have these before multiple times, we can see like maybe the customer tried to attempt more than once. So it's really tough because we can't really get a good picture of what happened when. So what we could do is what a support person would do is you copy all these logs into, say, a notepad from the system API and a process API, and then you kind of sort them by timestamps. So maybe you can get a better picture of what the customer did. And then, but the only thing is too with that as well is if this customer signed up for other things or did a whole bunch of get calls, we'd also have to filter out all their email equals Craig Anderson on their get calls as well too. So it's kind of a pain and a lot of manual effort for the support person to do that. But if we go back to a developer can actually help them with this exact issue. And that is with a thing called a correlation ID. So if you've ever noticed inside a request connector, if you scroll down on this general tab, there's a little thing here called send correlation ID. And I have it on always, but the default is always anyways. So what is the correlation? What is the correlation ID and what are we sending? So let me show you what a correlation ID is. I'm going to put a breakpoint here and we're going to start up this code. So what I have here is I'm starting up a project with both the system and process API at once. They're just running on different ports so that they can talk to each other so we can get the full end-to-end. So I'm going to debug it. And you just gotta wait for it to start. Now we should get a message that has started for both of them. Come on, no failed, no failed, no failed. Seems to be taking a little bit longer, but here we go. So we can set up our postman. And I'm going to switch to local so it hits my local and not the cloud hub. And what I'm going to do is just, I guess I could set in any request. That's okay, they're both deployed, which is good. So I'm going to get to that breakpoint in our process API. Okay, so this is the first step after we accepted that postman request. And if you see here in the debugger, there's this top level variable or attribute called correlation ID. And it seems to be just some random, really long GUID. So it starts with 1090. So if I step through that correlation ID, and we'll look at our logs, you'll see that the correlation ID 1090 starts with is actually in our logs as well too. So the correlation ID is getting printed out to our logs. And this is actually because of our log4j. So inside our log4j, by default, you can specify the pattern of each log message that comes that you print out. So you'll see here, this is just the default one that comes with MuleSoft projects. But you'll see that this percent sign 5P, that's the info. And then the percent sign D, which is the date. And then you have in the square brackets, which is, I guess, the thread or consumer type. And then you'll see here where a correlation ID is inside square brackets with event colon and then a correlation ID. So in log4j, this is called a lookup variable. So log4j is able to look up variables on what they call a context map. And MuleSoft is allowing the correlation ID variable to be put onto this map to be read. So and this is important because you'll see how it gets passed to the system API. So if I go back to my debug mode, you'll see the correlation ID again starts with 1090. I go into my system API, and because I have that setting that says always send a correlation ID, now that I'm inside my other application, my system API, you'll see my correlation ID hasn't changed. It's 1090. So if I go to that log message, you'll see here that it's the exact same ID. So if I go to find, there two are they it got passed between the system API, the process API, and the system API application. So this is actually, it's kind of neat because now what we can do is we can trace requests through multiple MuleSoft applications. So again, we set this up for our customer, for our support person that is a developer. And now what they can do is say they go into here and they're looking at, they search for the customer ID and they can go, okay, this was the very first, say this request here. So they'll take this one. Let me get one that's started, finished. One that's, sorry, I'm in my system API. Let me go back to my process API. So they can take one of these received customer requests, the support person, take this ID and see, now filter out all of this customer's other requests and just specify on one trip through one of their requests, one of their clicks on the website. So then from here, I can take these two and see what happened on the system API. By going to the system API and using that exact same correlation ID. So now I don't really have to line up all those requests and filter through them. The support person can just take those four and print it out. And the runtime manager doesn't have this logging feature, but something like a Splunk or a Sumo Logic, you can actually search multiple log files at once. So if you were to click the system API and the process API files to search and just put in this ID, well, then all your work is already done as a support person. You can just report back like instantly back to the ticket with something like, okay, I can see the first request to create the account, and we can have the timestamp because it's easier. We can see when it came in, and then we can actually filter out how many requests they were because of the IDs. So we can come back with more information that says, yeah, a few more times later, we also saw the request again, and all of them, we verified all of them were successful. And we, since in the system API, we were able to see that the success insert message was there, we can say that all the customer accounts are in the database. So we don't even have to go into the database to verify because we have the success calls. So this correlation is pretty neat. And we can kind of see how it's actually implemented across MuleSoft. If we implement, if we go into our log4j and allow debug messages of the HTTP module, we can see how this correlation ID variable gets passed from the process API to the system API. Just gotta wait for this to start up again. So it's both deployed. So let's get this step through. So you see our correlation this time is another random number. This is O, starts with 097. And in our logs, we're actually setting that log for J to debug mode. We can actually see the whole payload that came in from the postman. And then we're going to see it going from the process API to the system API. So you can see here, here's the post that I just started my server. Here's the post coming from the postman, and here's the post request coming from the process to the system API. And you can see here that our correlation ID starts with 097 is actually being pass through a header called xcorrelation ID. And this is how the system API is using this correlation ID. So it's checking to see if this header exists. And if it does, well, let me just take that one and not generate a new one. And you'll see here that it actually did. So we're in our system API application and it's using that 097. So now that we know that the header is being passed through a header, like what happens if we overwrite this header? So if we put in our postman request and let's use that exact same header, xcorrelation ID, and set it to some random unique number that we generated. Let's put that back in. And our process API, which was the one responsible who made up the correlation ID, is now taking the one we just set through the header. So now you can see it starts with 00AAA, and that's what it was, 00AAA. And then that one gets used to pass through the header, sorry, through a header to the system API. You can see here that's the header with our request. And now the system API uses it even for all of its login. So this is kind of neat. Why would we want to set our own header ID? Well, with this well-designed API, what if we could turn this into a standard for other parts of the business? So what if we had, for all our Mule APIs, we made this X correlation ID header mandatory? So if our website and our use case wanted to call our API, they would have to generate this UUID on their side, and which of course is pretty easy. Like if you want to use, Java has a static class UUID that can generate a random one with just one call. So we force them to generate one, and if they want to join in on us helping the support team, they can use that correlation ID to log their tasks in their systems. So that would be a big win for the team. So now the support person can take that correlation ID into other applications that are non-Mule related and follow the path all the way across from the website into MuleSoft and then back to the customer back through the website. And then they can see, because we already determined there was no error in our systems. So it's got to be somewhere. So this way the support person can easily trace that back into the other system to look to see if there's an error in there. So that would be a big win for everybody. So the support person wouldn't spend too much time getting the answer. So they weren't confused by the logs and they didn't need to pull in a developer, which possibly could be us, to figure out what happened. And most importantly, they got the answer quickly to help resolve the customer's problem. And one thing I did want to point out just for complete sake, that in Mule 3, this actually functionality isn't there, but I actually created myself. So the functionality, the logic is actually quite simple. What you do is you just start up in Mule 3, you put a choice here that checks for a header. In this case, it doesn't have, in Mule 3, because you're doing it yourself, it doesn't have to be X-correlation-ID. You can call it whatever you want. If the company has a standard, you can use it there. And then if that header exists, then just set it to a variable called like event ID. And if it doesn't exist, well, then you can just call in DataWeave, you can just call the UUID function to generate a random number. Set that to the event ID variable. But the only thing is you'll have to add it to all your logs yourself. So you'd have to do something like flowvars.client ID or correlation ID or whatever you want to call it. And you have to put this to every log. But if you put the same choice logic on the system API as well as the process API, well, then you're creating the same functionality. You can pass it. All your logs can be joined in, can be combined together for easy searching for the support people. So in summary, we build our applications to not just solve the end customer's issues, but also to support the application going forward. And the number one to do this is through our logging. Our exercise that we did today walked through a typical task that a support person have to do frequently. By understanding what their job entails, we were able to make them more efficient by what we wrote, what logging we added to our application. So on a side note, I kind of see quite often where people in applications, they'll log the full payload as soon as a request comes in, or they'll have a message at the very end of their flows that all it says is like done. I've actually seen this multiple places. So if you have this information, the support person, this can't do anything with this. Like this is not for them. They can't take the payload that you log, fire up AnyPoint Studio, load in your Mule project, and step through your code. So these messages are only to help you, the developer. So unless you want to be called in every time there's a production issue, you need to give support the tools to do their job. So in helping them, it in turn helps you to be able to focus on your development tasks and have a better work-life balance. It helps the customer care agent because they can help the customer quickly. And more importantly, it helps the support person because they can answer the customer care quickly. And then in turn, and most importantly, it helps the end customer who can get their accounts created and start using their product, using our products and services. And that's the end of presentation number two. Again, these are the links. Please subscribe to my channel if you want more tutorials, as well as if I went real quick or you had to take a break, I'll repost these soon, these presentations as well. And then hit me up on LinkedIn and grow your network on there. Thanks, Alexandra. Back to you.
Thank you. All right. So quiz number two. I hope everyone's ready. Here we go. So question six. Whose job relies on the production logs the most? Okay, we already have someone. The support team / person. Question seven. What is the name of the unique ID that gets passed between MuleSoft applications? You guys are just so quick. Yeah, correlation ID. Right, question eight. How can you set a breakpoint for a connector to debug your Mule app? This is just a random question. The answer is right click on the connector and select toggle breakpoint. This, you can just answer true or false. I'm just telling you in advance. You can grant user access to an environment directly. How did you guys answer so quickly? I wasn't even showing the question yet. Okay, the answer is false. To grant a user access to an environment, you have to use role permissions, and there is a link if you don't trust me. All right, question 10. What is the retention period for audit logs? I don't see. Oh, I see the right question now, but all right, there you go. So it's actually 6 years. Again, if you don't believe me, you can go to the link. It's right there. I swear I checked it today again. All right. So if you have any questions for Jason, go ahead. Just one at a time, please.
Hey, everybody. This is Ali. Thanks, Jason, for all this. And thanks, Alexandra, for scheduling this. I have a quick question about the logging and the correlation ID, right? So we did touch upon the correlation ID and how we can toggle through all the apps or all the layers in API LED. But any considerations with business events or Titanium with monitoring that you would also recommend along with correlation ID?
Yeah, so business events. So you mean like the monitoring around the business events that you set?
Yes, yeah, so enabling business events tracking with monitoring.
Yeah, so I definitely wouldn't just recommend just activating business events. So what I try to recommend with MuleSoft is try to be part of the bigger company. So don't be like MuleSoft APIs are separated from the rest of the applications. So if you're at a big organization that has Java Spring APIs, it has TIBCO, try to see if you can attach to their existing systems. So that like if they do something like maybe we only do email monitoring, then try to hook up maybe a business event to that. A lot of times what support people end up doing is having like 15, 20 screens open, trying to monitor everything at once. So if you've ever sat with them, they're like, oh, I got to check here. And then I got to check here. And then I got to check here. So I'd say the first thing to do is try to see if you can use your Mule code and logic to connect to their existing systems. And then if you can use business events or monitoring or any kind of the trigger there, Yeah, then I would recommend, of course, using the tools MuleSoft has so you don't have to build stuff from scratch.
Hey, two points, Jason. I noted down when he was presenting, and I don't want to mention those. Like when you showed correlation ID and it was coming back from another APIs or another systems, right? So that you can do undistributed tracing down there. But one point to note there is even if the other system is not sending you correlation ID, the correlation ID that you had generated there from your process API also goes back as a response to the calling system. So if they are logging or if they are not sending, still want to find out, they can always look in the header and tell you, oh, this is the correlation ID that I had received from your system. Can you see what happened with this one? So HTTP listener will always return the correlation ID also back. So if you call this, and I think if you look in the response header, you should be able to see the correlation ID that your app generated. I mean, because sometimes it's not within our control to enforce other system to generate the headers in there. Go in there, it's not there.
That might be the request. Let me see.
I have seen it. I have seen it. X correlation ID always goes back in the response also. So that way you can, even if they are not sending, you can always send them back. Whether they use it or not, it's up to them. But if your customer is having issue, you can ask them, okay, can you just open the, if it's a web application, you can ask them, open your web app, see the reference, this correlation ID in the response and tell me that, and I can like pinpoint exact request, right?
Yeah, and if you ever want it to be on a specific header name, you can always add it in like these responses here.
Yeah.
If you know exactly, like if you have a standard on your MuleSoft team that hey, correlation ID is always whatever. Well, actually, correlation ID is a top level element, so you can just call it like this, correlation ID, and you'll actually get it. And then you could put the header name as yeah, so X correlation ID or whatever you want to call it. You can just, if it's something you're making it up, you could just do something like this. Thanks for that, Manik. Yeah, if you have anything else, like if you want to message me offline, yeah, go right ahead. Hit me up on LinkedIn. Pretty active on there.